Someone sent me something just a while ago that said, it was a funny quote that said, the hard part about being a parent is you realize that most of your child's bad traits they got from you. That's so true. Or I've noticed it's terrifying to raise a child and your child has all these great features and including high intelligence that they lose in their teens or adulthood. Or you put everything you have into raising a child, but you actually give them so much that they become lazy and abusive, and or they become so perfect, more exquisite than a diamond, that they marry a very abusive person that destroys their dignity and their spark and ruins their whole life. Or you educate your child and roll out the red carpet for them and hope that you've provided the best of everything to make them an achiever and to offer great things for society, only to see them have several children and throw the education away. You know, you never can predict what a kid is going to turn out like. Just know, like, you can never predict what a human is really made of. When I was young in school, I remember I always had this vision into the future. I always have had. I guess God's been talking to me, like I said, my whole life. And I've always seen deep into everything. And so when I was young and I thought that I was just this ugly duckling, I remember these people were asking my mom if I would model when I was 18. And I thought, well, I had real bad TMJ, so my face always swelled, always. But I always saw imperfections in myself. First, I had a lazy eye. Then I had to wear these glasses all through kindergarten, first grade, second grade. And then little kids used to always say, are you Chinese? And when I was in elementary school. But when I got older, they no longer asked me that because I developed more and I got bigger. I was just a runt. And with those cat-eye glasses, my eyes really looked tiny. And so I never could have confidence. Because see, if you have a handicap, like I did, poor hearing, a lazy eye, you always get taken advantage of. You are always abused. No matter who you know or what you do, you're abused because you never feel good as anybody else. And today I was going through McDonald's and there's this guy and he was talking real loud and it was hard to understand him. And I said, the intercom is set too high. So I go up to the window and I said, you know, you have a very powerful voice. You be good as a business professional. I said, like a coach or something, because your voice is so strong. I said, but you should just be proud. You've got that kind of voice. And then I get up to the other window and I said, is he into like coaching or like, is he a business professional? And she said, he's almost deaf. He can't hardly hear. He has a hearing aid. I'm like, oh my God. I'm like, join the club. I said, you can have one guy drive through here and say, God, you sound like a very confident person. You know, confidence can impression a lot of people. Why don't you be a self-help coach or like some of these gurus to get out there and make a fortune teaching people to get wealthy? He sounds like that kind of guy. But actually, he has low self-esteem. He's just got a powerful voice through years of being handicapped. And it brought me back to my youth when I was overlooked and stomped on. And I remember when I went to the first writers' conference, my voice was pretty faint. And I thought everyone there was where I wanted to be. I wanted to be published. So I felt like I was just open, gullible. I wanted so badly for someone to say I had something that they could use. And that is how the people that are taking over the world are abusing people. But I always had this heart that would give everything away for free. So I started off just wanting to help the world. And my whole intention of using my voice was I admired the prophets in the Bible. And I always admired them. And I said, someday I want to be able to use my talent to be like a prophet, to work for Jesus. That was my only goal, to use my visions, higher power, and my talent to help the whole world, to help people that lack confidence like myself learn to have confidence, and to help people that were spiritually broken from years of abuse or neglect and being overlooked, that they can never see their real gift, learn to use it. And I remember Jack Canfield came up to me the first conference and put his hand on mine to feel my energy. And I remember another writer said I had real talent. And I remember the guy that hosted the conference said I had real talent, but I had to come to another one so that I could polish it. Oh yeah, no one told me my work was used for more than 2 stories the first year. And I went to 6 conferences. And later, when I got sick of being abused online, belittled, tortured, and I couldn't understand why people hated me when all I wanted to do was love and give from the bottom of my heart stories to share to help the world, I was told, well, we fed off of you. We really hate you. We led you to the edge of a cliff. Now go kill yourself. We got what we wanted. You silly little fool. We're wealthy. I said, but I was always loving and giving, and I gave you anything you wanted. I said, I was trusting. And they said, silly little fool, we like to sneak up behind people. They said, our go is to sneak up behind you. I'm like, but why do you sneak? Why do you want to hurt me when I just purely wanted to give it to you? And they said, well, I was beauty and innocence too powerful to resist, and they wanted to destroy my heart. And then later they wanted to destroy my soul. So when Paris Jackson started talking to somebody online she thought cared about her, which I figured was probably a setup to try to do to her what they did to me, they told her to kill herself. Well, I was told to kill myself for a few months. And they had me in such a dark place, they even threatened to murder my parent if I didn't kill myself. Can you imagine being told after having your heart completely broken because you gave everything you had for years and only to be told by the devil that we want you to kill yourself, you're of no use anymore, we got what we wanted, and we're doing this to all these other people? So when they said we're doing this to all these other people, I had to go try to tell young people. I went to the universities. I went to all the different police stations and detective agencies in different cities and FBI. And I said, look, you have to save these people. Only later I found out that that these people had made an empire off of it, and they had already slaughtered and deceived so many young people and used them through the entertainment industry and used them through the porn industry. What were they going to do? So here today, they want my brain, they want my soul, and they're telling me to get my fire back. They destroyed my fire when they destroyed my brain. All I wanted to do was love, and when they couldn't make me evil through torture, they just gave me a lobotomy. They just killed me. They just made me handicapped. I got bone density -2 the first year someone came in my home and all this torture started and they started burning me. My bone density it's been 10 years now, I had it tested. It was -2 from their weapons, and my bones have disintegrated since then. And they're blinding me, and they've attacked my liver now to where my stool stays white from whatever they've done. It's liver damage. My liver readings are bad. My thyroid is underactive. They attack my kidneys. They just can't understand why I'm still alive. This is the kind of world that kids are being raised in. So I was right when I was a teenager, when I saw all these billboards full of young girls being exploited, and I saw these modeling agencies come to town that tried to get women to get into prostitution. One time, one of them asked me to come to a party, and the first party, women were straddling men doing gymnastics with their clothes on, and they were just like having sex with their clothes on in the main party room. When I was 18, I was asked by some people if I would model at 18 before I had car accidents and stuff that damaged my face, and made it swell all the time. I had no confidence, but I went to one party, and everybody went upstairs that owned businesses, like radio stations, and they all did heroin, and they all did drugs. I had never even French kissed a boy at the time. I felt so out of place. I felt like something was wrong with me. Even when I worked at KFC, the manager and stuff invited us to a company party after I was there a year. I was in my teens. I went because I worked at KFC through high school. I went over there, and all these people were doing drugs around me, and they were drunk. And the one party I went to with the managing editor of the Courier Journal, I was still a virgin, but he wanted to take me home because he said he couldn't drive. He was too drunk. So then he tried to have his way with me at his house, but I wasn't interested. I had a crush on a grocery store boy I'd liked for 4 years, and he was the only person I liked. I just went to this party because the guy seemed classy because of who he was. I thought I was a journalist. I was majoring in journalism in high school, I was a feature editor in my newspaper, so I thought, with him working in a newspaper, he's got to be classy. Well, he wasn't classy. So finally, I stayed up all night long. I didn't get any sleep. I had to be at work the next day at Stewart's. He drove me to White Castle, where I had parked my car at the bridge over in New Albany, so I could drive to work. I had to rush to work. It was raining that day. And I remember I got to the end of Churchill Downs, and I stopped at the light, and I hadn't had anything to eat. Now, I was had very high hyperglycemia. I had hyperglycemia all through high school because I went through a phase of anorexia, and I was just too skin and bones. And I ate baby cereal once a day and a little bag of Doritos for the whole summer, and that's all I'd eaten. So I was at the light, and I remember it turning green, and then as I was pulling out, I remember there was this dark car, and it was coming at me so fast, I couldn't stop. And so all I remember is I got hit on the left. That should have killed me, but because I didn't have my seatbelts on, it flew me into the windshield and busted the glass and ran into a utility pole and took chips out of the utility pole. And I went through a newspaper stand too. And then when they found me, I was on the passenger side and didn't know my name. So for ages, it took me a couple years to get my grammar back, to start to know things. I couldn't even remember what happened at the accident. That happened in my teens, and for a few years after that, I could never drive. I was too scared. Every time I would get to an intersection, I would grab the dash or yell, and I was freaked out. And because of that, I could never get behind the wheel of a car. So then I started taking the bus everywhere. Until I met my husband, I was too scared to drive. And he didn't know I hadn't driven. And I kept telling him, I won't drive, I won't drive, I won't drive. And after we dated a while, he got me on the interstate. He gave me the keys and said, you're going to drive. I said, no, no, no. I don't know how I can drive. It's been 10 years, you know. I'm afraid. He got me driving that day and showed me what I could do. But I had other car accidents. And a lot of them damaged, like my knees and other parts of my body. And there's a lot of reasons I would be frightened. But yet I was still trusting of people, loving of people, would give people anything they wanted, loved unconditionally. And I got abused so many times by doctors I trusted that did permanent damage. The first doctor damaged me was I was 18, and he put me under old time Novocaine. And he worked on me so many hours, he didn't know my jaw was dislocated. So when he tried to force it closed with it out of place, it pulled all the stuff in here loose by his force, not knowing my jaw was dislocated. Then after that, other doctors that negligence. One guy left. When they first started doing MRI machines, this one guy went to use me as a guinea pig. So he left me an MRI machine for 2 hours and 45 minutes. And people were complaining a week later the machine had overheated. So for over a year, I would bang in the doorways. Every time I went through a room, I could not go straight through a doorway. I'd got a hematoma on the windowsill of when I leaned with my head back in bed. I was having all these accidents because I had braces at the time, and the overheating machine, being there as a test guinea pig for 2 hours and 45 minutes, had did damage to me. And then I went to a doctor in Las Vegas. Turned out it was Elvis's doctor, and went there to try to get treatment for overheating. My body was overheating, and it felt like I was being baked by the sun and out in the sun. And that was traumatizing because after I got out of the machine, I remember feeling I didn't have a conscience anymore. I remember crying because my best friend got sick at the time, Sister Alwina. And I wanted to feel closer to her, and I wanted to feel such remorse. But I couldn't understand what had happened to that deep love. I loved her. People said it's because you loved her so much. You were angry that she was dying, that you loved her so much, that was what was traumatizing you, was just your guard of not wanting to lose her. But to me, it seemed like being in the machine that long had killed my conscience. I felt if you put me in a brain scanner, I would have missing parts, like I was a serial killer, because I thought I had no feeling after that machine. But then later, it all came back. And then my MRIs and everything were perfectly normal. Even when my husband did them for me, before this group came in my home, they were perfectly normal. But now this group is like trying to deaden areas in my brain, to destroy all feeling and everything. But if I had never gone to this conference, I would have had a good shot at life of living my dreams, of being happy. Now they tell me, you must be one with Satan. You must lose your power. You must surrender your love. You must lose all feeling. And I'm in total disbelief. This is a nightmare. But I'm trying to heal. Only when they do these terrible things to me, they want to torture you every day to where you have no comfort zone. Comfort zone is what God gives you. It's like a child with a teddy bear. If you can just self-soothe yourself, like giving a baby a pacifier, you can get through almost any tragedy in the world, because God gives us everything we need. But when they're in your mind, when they can read your mind. And they don't let you do those things. And they spent several years of not letting you have more than 3 or 4 hours of sleep all those years when you already have sleep apnea and you're supposed to use a machine because you stop breathing. And you're already messed up in the brain because no matter how much sleep you get, the doctor tells you it's not efficient because it's not, you're not getting into the right sleep state because of this disorder. And if you don't use your machine, you never get into the dream state. But when these people start hacking your brain at the same time, knowing you have this disorder, knowing that your life is already shortened by it, that life insurance people wouldn't give me the lowest premium. They are ruthless predators that really want to experiment and kill me. Because after years of me going to the emergency room, the doctor not letting me leave because he says I'm sleep deprived, making me take 2 Valium and go to sleep or I can't leave the hospital, telling me I'm dying because I'm not getting enough sleep, and these people continue doing this to me knowing what the emergency room doctors say, that tells you they only want to kill you and dissect you. So now when I see these parents talking about how they want to raise their children decent, I'm like, how can you teach your child to love itself, to have self-respect for others, when these predators are raising society today to accept abuse, to be abused? I mean, I was abused plenty through my own childish love for humanity and my own ideals that I can make the world a better place through God's love, through truth and peace and fight in war. That got me hurt enough without taking these lambs and teaching them to be abused and used and discarded, to give predators money that stole my life and dreams from me that now want to rip my heart out. This is a grim fate for every person in the world that's not a monster. The kind of people running the world today are the kind of people that should be on an island somewhere for criminals or put in a pit somewhere and never let out. Because we are born with such a pure heart that if the world was run by people that valued humanity and wanted to help people really heal and grow, the world could be a promised land. You know, you would believe in angels, but they're hiding the miracles that are taking place. They're killing the angels because the people in charge can't feel good about themselves unless they create an evil society because they've already given sold their souls to Satan. So how in the world can you exist in the world? They want to redo the world just for Satan. They even want to have demon babies. They even want to destroy man through machines. They've already domesticated dogs. Are they just trying to bring out just the evil in man? It will only lead to man's downfall, and eventually the world will be destroyed